You cannot try twice as hard and have a baby in 4.5 months. Doesn't matter. You can't try that. Like, it's not going to happen. Same thing with this. You cannot try to speed up and get ready sooner, because days are still 24 hours. And the human body still requires time for the physiological changes to the muscles, the tendons, the ligaments to occur, which is why people are advocating for at least a 6-week preseason to make sure that the body had time to adapt.
What's happening, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of 3-Cycle Strength, the show for strength and conditioning coaches who are serious about getting better and giving back. Today, we are going to be addressing the question that seems to be on everybody's mind about coming back from this crazy pandemic nightmare that we've all been living in, and how that's going to look, and the concept that we're going to be kind of looking at that question through the lens of is acute to chronic training. We're going to talk with a coach who is very passionate about the subject. He's going to kind of break down the fundamentals for us, talk a little bit about how it applies to just a normal, if there is such a thing, a normal year's training schedule, and the different breaks that you have in training and coming back from those things, but also how it applies very much to what we're all experiencing in regards to return to play after what we're experiencing with the coronavirus is over. Of course, we're going to get to strength stories, tools of the trade, and food for thought, as well as a nice little kilograms clip. So don't go anywhere after the main conversation is over. You won't want to miss any of that as well. Let me remind everybody once again, as I do every week, to subscribe, like, follow, share, comment, review. All of those things are very important to the health of our platform and our ability to provide you with excellent content week in and week out. And we always appreciate it when you do those things. And without further ado, let's get to the conversation of the day. Our guest today is the Director of Sports Performance for Football at Towson University. Before that, he served on Chris Doyle's staff at Iowa for 5 years, where he also had a role in the sports science side of things, overseeing analytics in regards to heart rate variability and GPS tracking. He also had stops at Maryland and Harvard. He is certified by the CSCCA and the NSCA, and has his master's in strength and conditioning, and a freshly minted PhD, from what I understand, provided that everything went well yesterday. It is Coach Justin Lima joining us on 3-Cycle Strength. Am I accurate in my representation? Is it official yet, or are we still waiting on some sort of, you know, ominous dominus blessing here before
it's
official?
No, it's official. Got the ballot in my email yesterday from my committee. Everybody passed me with no revision, so it is official. I can put those three letters, and it is official.
I don't know if you're like me. I find it hard to brag on myself sometimes, but you know, that's something that I would be telling everybody.
Yeah, same way. Don't like to talk about myself, but you know, it was nice. I finished my defense yesterday, and they told me that I passed. And you know, my wife had congratulations, Dr. Lima, on balloons, and so that was nice. And my family, and you know, people have been texting me, so it's been really nice. And like I said, it didn't really seem real, and it's slowly starting to sink in that the process is over.
Yeah, I mean, let me add my voice in there. I mean, that's an awesome achievement, and you deserve to get patted on the back a little bit for it. So you know, that's really, really cool. And I'm glad that the timing worked out that we could do this, you know, right the day after. I think that's pretty sweet too, and give you a little bit of shine for it. You deserve it. That's awesome, man.
Appreciate it. Thanks, Adam.
Obviously, before every episode, I have to kind of creep on you guys on social media and, you know, do my homework and that sort of thing. And I realized that some of my favorite Packer players, we're all cheeseheads, our offices are here in Wisconsin. Some of my favorite Packers came from University of Iowa, and I saw that you had shared a video clip of Mike Daniels talking about how all they do at Iowa is, you know, eat chicken breasts and lift heavy weights. And then that got me thinking about your experience there. And I know that, you know, you really treasure that, the knowledge and being able to kind of be with Coach Doyle, who is one of the best in the business. Some would argue the very best, and I would not make a case against that argument. But yeah, you know, I was just wondering, you know, is it true that they just eat chicken breasts and lift heavy weights? And, you know, what are the behind the scenes stories that you can share from your time at Iowa?
I mean, the saying that I have around here is you cannot outwork a bad diet. And that definitely came with me from the University of Iowa. We preached that. I believe last year they had spent like the third most amount of money in the entire country on feeding their student athletes. So it for sure is chicken breasts and every other kind of lean source of protein combined with proper training. So, you know, whether you're squatting, lunging, bench pressing, whatever it is, we're going to stress you, but then we're going to give you the proper rest. Because another thing that we always said and that I say here a lot is stress plus rest equals growth. So you have to stress the body. The body is one organism, stress it, but if you do not provide it rest, it's not going to grow. When you provide two and you provide them both really well, good training with good food, you get growth. And that's how you see that kind of development that they have at the University of Iowa. And that's why they wanted to bring me here at Towson, because we're both very similar. We don't acquire talent here or at the University of Iowa. Yeah, they have a lot of high draft picks and they do have a lot of really good talent, but they take pride on developing talent. Other schools collect talent. You know, even the James Madisons and the Delawares around here, they can kind of collect and pick and choose who they want, very similar to the Ohio States and Michigans in the Big Ten. And having somebody come from the University of Iowa, where we had to develop our talent with good training plus good recovery and good nutrition, that's why they wanted to bring me here, because that's what we have to do. We have to take kids that played tight end and make them turn into tackles. Or we have to take kids that were linebackers and move them, you know, to a defensive line position. So somebody that had 5 years worth of experience seeing, like you said, arguably one of the best in the business, that's why I was granted the opportunity to come here and help, you know, change the way that they train, help change the way that we do our nutrition and how we stress them and rest them. Like I said, it's stress plus rest equals growth. That's why, you know, Mike was talking about it's chicken breasts and heavy 45-pound plates.
You're watching 3 Cycle Strength. Make sure you subscribe and hit that notification bell. So let's transition now to kind of the main event of the day. I know that in conversations that we've had in the past, you know, we did a panel for our American Football Coaches Association audience not too long ago. And I remember in the moment, you know, jotting down real quickly that this was the topic that I needed to talk to you about, because your passion kind of came through. And obviously the amount of time that you've invested into, you know, building your knowledge base about it. But it's this idea of acute to chronic training. So for coaches that, you know, aren't familiar with that concept, or maybe, you know, they're just getting into strength and conditioning and they're trying to, you know, widen their knowledge base, you know, lay out a little bit of the basics of it. And then maybe we can kind of talk about, you know, how it applies to your training philosophy.
Yeah. So the biggest thing with the acute to chronic stuff is just thinking about your chronic workload is what you've done, right? Your fitness and what you're prepared for. And then your acute is the fatigue and what you've immediately done. Most of the time, it's 28 days is your chronic workload, right? Like what you've done over a 4-week span of time. And your acute workload is what you've done over a week. There's a couple different models where, you know, you look at in your 28 days, do you include the week that you're in? Do you not include the week that you're in? It doesn't really matter to me, as long as the biggest thing is you're taking into consideration what the athletes have done in preparation for what you're asking them to do. And I think that right now is the utmost of importance, because a lot of these guys, their chronic workload, you don't know what they've done. You have to assume that they haven't done anything. So if you think about your acute workload is your, you know, 7 days or what you're going to ask your athletes to do when they come back. Your chronic workload, the 28 days or the 4 weeks prior, you have to assume is next to nothing. I know you're going to talk with your athletes and you're going to find out, but you cannot assume and you cannot go based off of their word, because there's a reason that we all have jobs, right? Our human beings, they're gonna be like water. They're gonna take the path of least resistance. And the reason why we sport performance coaches have jobs is we're gonna ask kids to do things that are difficult. You know, they're gonna do the training that they want to do, so their acute training is going to be low. But just keeping that in the back of your mind, okay, what have they done for the past 28 days? What have they done in the last 7 days? And then the easiest way, you just calculate it. Okay, week one, arbitrarily, they did 2,000 yards of running. Week two, 2,000 yards of running. Week three, 2,000 yards of running. So their chronic workload is 2,000. If you ask them in week four to do 4,000 yards of running, their acute to chronic ratio is going to be 2, right? 4,000 divided by 2,000. There's a lot of research out there by a guy named Tim Gabbett. I know there are a lot of other people out there that have researched the topic, but they have found that the optimal acute to chronic work ratio is 0.8 to 1.3, right? So staying in that middle. And then there's a little bit of a buffer zone after 1.3 up until 1.5. So just making sure you don't go out of that. One thing for a lot of coaches to understand is when you've done nothing, so your 4 weeks prior is zero, no matter what you do, your acute to chronic ratio is going to be all out of whack because you're building them and getting their fitness level back up. Again, that's what the chronic is. It's their fitness. It's what they're able to handle, versus the acute is the fatigue that you're going to put on them. So if you know that no matter what you do at first, it's going to be a lot to them, plan that in advance. Start uncomfortably easy, so that way you can add over time, and then you can keep your athletes healthy. Because let's say you have, 16 hours and you've got 4 weeks, 16 hours per week, and you're going to utilize that for 4 weeks. You do the math on that, that'd be 64 hours. Well, if you come out of the gate and you do all of that time when your athletes aren't prepared, now you'll lose time because they might be injured and they're going to be in the training room, or they're not going to be on the field because you did too much too soon. So while in theory you could practice for 16 hours by 4 weeks and you can have all that time, you're not going to have all your kids on the field because they're going to be hurt because they haven't done enough work. They don't have that chronic workload to handle it throughout the week. So that's where if you start smaller, 10 hours, build 12 hours, 14, 16, that will allow your athletes. Yes, it's not 64 hours, but you're not actually getting 64 hours because you're going to lose kids due to injury.
And obviously I wanted to ask you about injury prevention as it ties into this. Obviously it sounds like there are a lot of things that understanding this concept can really impact that in a huge way. It makes me think about, preseason injuries or camp injuries versus in competition injuries with your athletes, because, for a lot of coaches, you'll see people dropping like flies in camp or, obviously like at the NFL level during preseason, you see all these major injuries occurring because they expect to be able to go like they're in midseason and they want it to be hard. And certainly coaches, to your point, what you were commenting on earlier about being uncomfortably easy, they certainly tend to embrace the uncomfortably hard before they embrace the uncomfortably easy, right? There has to be a tie-in there as far as, the body has not had the opportunity to, catch up and get those reps that they need to be prepared, and yet you want to push them like competition before they're ready.
So the easiest analogy to your point is, I feel like everybody be like, we've got to get back. We want to go. We're going to try really hard and we're going to try to speed up the recovery process or the training process. And the biggest takeaway is just understand that we're talking about physiological changes to the human body, to the muscle, to the tendons, to the ligaments. Like, we're talking about physiological changes. That takes time. It doesn't matter how bad you want it or how hard you want to try something. So an analogy is you cannot try twice as hard and have a baby in 4.5 months. Doesn't matter. You can't try that. Like, it's not going to happen. Same thing with this. You cannot try to speed up and get ready sooner because days are still 24 hours. And the human body still requires time for the physiological changes to the muscles, the tendons, the ligaments to occur, which is why people are advocating for at least a 6-week preseason to make sure that the body had time to adapt. And if most situations, you know, with the guidelines allowing people to come back, you know, next week, June 1st, if you even plan this out and work backwards, because that's the easiest way as a strength and conditioning coach, you start backwards. Like, okay, what's the end and goal? Where are we starting? And if you work backwards, if you go over an 8-week progression, you know, based upon what a normal game week looks like, you can, you know, take a deload week the week before game week, but you can actually overreach and do more than a game week. So let's say you wanted to do 15% more of a normal game week volume of practice to make sure that your body was resilient, because we're trying to build anti-fragile, resilient athletes who can handle a lot of work. So you can give those athletes 115% of a volume come that third week of camp. The week prior, you could do 95%. The week prior, you could do 80%. That means you have to start camp at 80% of what a normal game week volume looks like. Okay, so what does that mean you're doing the weeks prior? You could come out and only do 65%. The week before that, 55. The week before that, 45. That means you're starting at 35%. So that's really that uncomfortable, like, man, this is too easy. But we talked about, if you know that they've done nothing for 4 weeks, whatever you do is going to be hard. So you might as well start easy. Another analogy, you can never unburn a cake. So you put a cake in the oven, if it gets burnt, it's burnt. There's nothing you can do about it. But you can check on the cake. Oh, you know what? We got to turn the temperature up a little bit. And you can keep heating the oven, but you cannot unburn a burnt cake. You cannot uninjure an injured athlete. So you can actually overreach and you can make it hard. And that's I feel like sometimes sport performance coaches, strength coaches, we can get a bad rap where it's like, oh, got to go easy. No, you have to train hard. You can make it where you overreach because you started really easy at first. And that's the biggest takeaway, is if you don't actually have easy days, you can't have hard days, because then you get into that training monotony where you do the same thing every single day. Best way to explain that to coaches is during this quarantine. When you had to stay home every single day, it was monotonous. Well, that's training camp, if you don't have a hard day and then an easy day. But if you had to stay home, then go to work the next day, stay home, go to work the next day, staying home wouldn't seem so bad. Same thing with practice. If you have a hard day, then an easy day, now your hard days are actually hard rather than just feeling hard. Because again, we're talking about physiological changes. So if you're going to run max velocity, you have to have rest, so that way the body and the creatine phosphate system can actually recover to allow maximal speed muscular contraction. Now, it'll feel hard if you do a max effort rep, don't rest a lot, but are you actually running at max velocity? The answer is no. So you're not actually increasing max speed. That's why you can actually practice harder by taking easier days. It's just all about, you know, planning it, knowing what they've done, what you want them to do. You just have to have a game plan and stick to that. It is. And that's, like I said, that's where you can make things harder, right? Like if we want to make this a hard day, let's make it a hard day. And now we can quantify, okay, what are we defining as hard? All right, it's going to be a lot of high speed distance. Okay. What drills are we doing to make sure that's a high speed distance day? If I tell my staff that we're going to have a training session and we're doing, you know, it's high speed distance and all of our accelerations are 10 or 15 yards, they can look at me like, what are you doing? Oh yeah, you're right. We need to be doing flying 10s, flying 15s. We need to be increasing the length to actually make sure we're hitting the quality that we want. Hey guys, I want to do a unilateral lift today. All right, well, you programmed, you know, trap bar deadlift, RDL, and glute ham raise. That's bilateral. Yep, you know what? You're right. Okay. Just having those parameters, like, okay, what kind of practice is it supposed to be? Is it short field? Is it long field? What are we doing? Have that plan, work together. Now, okay, we can organize the stress because like we talked about earlier, the body is one organism. It's going to respond to stress. Make sure you place the right stress on it so that way it can recover. And then you can actually, again, go hard the next day. It's not about just, oh, easy. No, you have to train hard. You have to train smart. You have to do both. It's not one or the other. That's why it's, just working together.
Well, I mean, I so appreciate you putting the cookies on the bottom shelf there, so to speak, breaking it down using those analogies, I think is so useful for coaches to, whatever we can do to, I don't think that, sometimes, and I hope it doesn't come off the wrong way, but sometimes, in the early going of this show, I've said things that when I watch it back, I think to myself, like, man, I hope I'm not coming off as super preachy, because I don't think that coaches are out there trying to do the wrong things. I don't think that they're out there, avoiding taking responsibility. And I think they really do have, a hunger for getting better and making sure that, they're dotting their I's and crossing their T's when it comes to taking care of their athletes and, getting the best out of them. But you have to know, right? You have to have that knowledge base. And so, you putting it in these terms and encouraging coaches to kind of look into this concept more and really understand it is so important. That's what I'm talking about when I say things like this, and I kind of have these throwaway comments where I'm like, some coaches struggle with this or that. And what I'm really saying is coaches need to continue to look into this area and educate themselves.
For sure. And like we talked about off camera earlier, the field is still in its infancy, right? I mean, it's the field of sports performance. I mean, we're starting to evolve. The first round of strength coaches are at the point where they're going to be able to retire rather than working multiple jobs. So the field is still really young, and we just have to keep pushing it forward, and we have to keep working with each other, and we have to understand, start breaking some of those stereotypes where it's like, look, we're not a hype man. I'm not a get back. I'm a professional. I just finished the dissertation. I had no classes on how to instruct athletes to get backwards behind a line. No classes about how to, headbutt a board or hype the guys up. Now, does that mean I'm a robot and have no energy? Absolutely not. But we have to start pushing the field forward and, demanding more out of ourselves to learn and improve just like any other profession. You want to be a good plumber? Learn. Get good at it, right? It's hold yourself to a higher standard, and that's how you will continue to push the field forward. And that's something that I, learned instantly at Harvard and Maryland and Iowa. You have to invest in yourself and continue to learn, whether it's reading, listening to the podcast. Like, this information, it's drinking from a fire hose right now. It's everywhere. So if you're not learning and trying to get better, it's the same thing we tell our athletes. I have a sign over here. It says, you're either coaching it or you're allowing it to happen. Same thing with yourself. You're either coaching it or you're allowing it to happen by not learning and not improving and not pushing it forward. Because I'm talking to you about it now, but I first learned about that acute to chronic. Okay, yeah, that makes it keep learning more and more. When I first learned about the GPS stuff, I was like, I have no idea. That you can get lost in all the variables. Boil it down. What are the variables that matter to you? Reach out to coach. When I was first on Skype calls all the time with those GP sport people, hey, explain this to me. What do I need to do? Still talking with, my catapult rep here now. She's awesome. She'll answer my calls. She'll answer my texts. We talk just to continue to learn about the process, because like we just said, it's a process. It's a never ending. You don't arrive, right? It's
right.
Still learning. You're still trying to get better. So that way you can improve, because as we talked about earlier, it's about relationships, and it's about serving the student athletes that you work with and the coaches that you work with, because it's never just about the same program every year. No, learn. How can I get better? What are other people doing? It's not copy and paste, but it's okay. As you learn how you get better at it. Mike Boyle is a well-known strength coach, and he had a good saying. It's like, at first you're a cook, you learn, you can take somebody's recipe and you just do that recipe, right? Like, if you've never cooked, follow a recipe on the back of it and just do it to a T. All right. Then after a while, you learn how to be a chef, where it's like, okay, I'm going to take some of these ingredients and then make it work for me. And that's where, you can't just be like, oh, I'm doing this model at this school. Well, do you have the weight room for it? Do you have the equipment? Do you have the facility? Are your athletes capable for it? Or do you understand the principles behind it? Same thing with the technology that we had at Iowa. Okay, what were we looking at when we had the GPS? Okay, we're looking at total volume. We're looking at workload. We're looking at recovery. All right, I have all those same tools, but how can I take those principles and apply it? And that's where if you're just continually learning, there's plenty of access to stuff out there.
Right on. I wanted to kind of take a step back and make sure that we're in the middle of this coronavirus and understanding how we're going to come back from that. And I think that you've done a really good job of outlining what that could look like and, you know, reinforcing with coaches about, you know, backwards planning and just how serious they need to take this and, you know, what it can look like and how it can be a little bit shocking when, like you said, you have this whole period of time where you don't know just how much athletes have been training. But I wanted to kind of take that into a step further into like what this could normally look like. Hopefully this isn't, obviously, I'm not an epidemiologist. I don't know exactly how what's going on right now is going to impact us long term, but let's say that we do eventually get back to some sort of normalcy here. What is this, how does this apply in just your, you know, in say a normal year, in your week to week, in your day to day, you know, what are the things that you're doing to make sure that you're taking this into consideration?
I would say just continue, like this is a, like you said, it's a difficult situation that nobody has done before, but the coaches that understand load management and understand principles, it's the coaches that have a program where they're like, oh, well, we just do this on this day because it's this week of the summer and that's what we do. Those coaches that have said, well, this is what we always do or that's how it was done in X program, those are the programs that are going to be exposed. But the programs that understand like the principles behind what they're doing, this is just going to be no different than any other time where it was, okay, the last time I had the athletes was here. We have them back at this time. What's my gap of time off? All right, from here, we got to get them ready to play a game this amount of time and then just work backwards. So following your principles. As I had said before, you can't try twice as hard and have your baby in 4.5 months. Like, so it's following that same principle. You can't try to make up for lost time. The body requires time for the physiological changes to happen. So yes, this is an extenuating circumstance, but if you know, okay, this is the start date, this is what I'm getting them ready for, and you work backwards knowing they haven't done much beforehand, what's my acute to chronic ratio? All right, what are the stressors that we're going to ask them to do? How can I minimally expose them to it and then slowly increase the volume over time to bring them along safely? Then you'll be okay. And that's no different than any other time. You know, in the FCS level, let's say you are fortunate enough to make the playoffs and you go two games in and then you're done playing December 9th or something. All right, if that happened for us, we wouldn't have our athletes back until January 27th. I know that's later than most schools. Some schools, let's say they bring them back 2 weeks earlier, so they come back January 13th. We're still talking about a month and a half layoff where it was Christmas, New Year's, right? So they had time away. You start off in January knowing that they've been away from you. And you start off slowly and then you slowly increase volume over time, exposing them to the stressors, acceleration, max velocity, decelerations, change of direction, upper body preparation. So we did all of that. We're always doing upper body preparation. We're looking at all those different qualities. And then we'll meet as a staff to make sure like, okay, hey, these are all the different qualities, you know, acceleration, we break it down, mirror, dodge, score, we break linear running into acceleration, top end work. These are the categories that we want to hit. This is how we break jumping into. It's jumping, leaping, hopping, make sure we hit all different planes of motion. How are we going to progress that from easy to hard over a 7-week phase from when we just got the athletes till spring break where spring ball happens? You just follow that same principle and understand easy at first, look at all the stressors we're going to ask them, How do you regress from the hardest thing you're going to do? Practice, 2 hours. All right, that's violent starts, stops, change of direction, violent punching. Regress that over 7 weeks and have your step-by-step in that. Like, then this is just, all you have to do is find out when you'll have your kids back, what you got to get them prepared for. Just like every team, they leave after finals, then they come back at some point during the summer. For us last year, they finished finals, you know, right around May 20th. We got them back the first Monday in June. So they had about 2.5 weeks off, right? Almost 3 weeks. You have to plan knowing that they're away from you. It's when you follow the principles, it's really, like I said, you're a chef at this point. When you're the cook and you're like, no, we have to do this program because this is what they did at X program. And on this day they run this. Yeah, you're in trouble. If you're that coach, the first thing I would say is you need to learn. You need to go and learn, talk to other coaches that follow the principles. And that would be my recommendation in terms, like for us, it's okay. Tell us when we have the athletes back. What are we getting them ready for? Let us do our job.
Hey everyone, just a quick reminder that 3-Cycle Strength is stronger with your feedback and input. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at 3-Cycle Strength, or shoot us an email at team@3cyclestrength.com. All right, it's time now for Strength Stories, the stories that forged who we are. Coach Lima, as I understand it, you weren't necessarily planning on becoming a strength and conditioning coach. So I'm wondering if you could share the story of how that came to be and how you found your way.
The biggest moment was when I actually decided that this is what I wanted to do. I have my bachelor's degree from Bridgewater in criminal justice. I graduated, you know, like 3.8, something really high, you know, did really well, and actually started graduate school for criminal justice. After I graduated, my offensive line coach asked me to come back and coach with him because, you know, I was kind of a coach on the field. I was a captain my senior year. Like, I understood our offense. And so I knew what to do, and he wanted help coaching there. So I started coaching with him, and I was working at his gym while I was taking grad school classes for criminal justice. And I was in criminal justice classes, knew the answers, and just didn't want to. The teacher would ask a question. Nobody would answer. I would eventually answer just because I didn't want the teacher to just kind of stand there in silence. But I was, and then, like, that kind of lit a bulb. I'm like, all right, all I can think about is football, strength and conditioning. Like, there's something's up here. Like, I got to figure it out. And then that same year, we played a game. We lost to somebody we shouldn't have. And I was having dinner with a kid that I played football with who had just, he graduated 2 years ago, and he was a strength coach at URI now, Mike Siriano, who's at Louisville right now. We were at dinner, and he's like, you know, you can, like, become a strength coach. And I had never really known that it existed because I'm from Massachusetts, and college football is not what it is everywhere else in the world in Massachusetts. So I did some research, figured out I could. I withdrew from all my classes in grad school for criminal justice and took that semester off. I was just, you know, coaching football, working in a gym, then started working with athletes and started my grad school process in 2010 at Bridgewater. So that's when I kind of found my passion. So just understanding, find your passion and then start working in a field that you're really passionate about. That was the biggest moment change for me as a coach, and then as a human being, when I had my first son, and then, you know, my other son now, just how important it is to spend time with them, and you know, they're always looking up to you. So that as a human being was a big game changing moment.
That's outstanding, and you know, it reinforces for me the importance of being a mentor and having that role as a strength and conditioning coach, looking out for those who are working with you, you know, your interns, your super seniors, whatever you want to call them, the athletes who are looking for direction and maybe this might be the right move for them. They need good role models to look up to and people to have these kind of conversations with them. Let's move on to our next segment, Tools of the Trade. You know, this is where we give coaches some practical advice, you know, some shared experience about products and services that other coaches in the field are using. So, you know, simply put, I just ask you, you know, what products and services do you like? You know, why do you like them? How do you use them? What are the tools of the trade for you?
So we talked about, you know, tracking. Very fortunate that our administration supported our vision to get Catapult. So that's been a huge tool for us, you know, utilizing that because of all the different widgets and the different spreadsheets. It's very user-friendly, and their customer support is unbelievable. That's why I would advocate for Catapult versus the other companies, just because you're going to get what you pay for, and their customer service is second to none, and the device is really good as well. But you're going to get really good customer service to help you be able to connect with your sport coach. So we talked about that one already. We also talked about the G-Flight. Like I said, I utilized that, used it in the dissertation. It had 93% validity and reliability compared to a force plate. So, I mean, it's costs way less, but love it because I'm able to do, you know, see right and left single leg asymmetries with my athletes for, you know, drop jump performance or just regular jump performance. So I like to have that instant feedback of ground contact time as well as jump height. And I like the fact that it's costs less than the jump mat. So in terms of like products, that's what I really go to. And then for continuing education, I don't think there's anything better than the Strength Coach Network. Strength Coach Network, I have links on my Instagram and Twitter to how to sign up and, you know, trials. But when I first found out about that from one of my former assistants, Joe Alexander, he showed me it, and just the different webinars and the different forums where you can learn and ask questions. Like I was helping somebody earlier today talk about, you know, if they wanted to go to PhD school. So it's just a great resource to learn. Plus there's a monthly webinar. Like, so right now there's 60 different webinars. So if you've never seen any of them, you've got over 60 hours of educational material. Over here in Maryland, there's a guy named Jay DeMayo who has the CVASP. That is a huge Central Virginia Sports Performance Seminar. All of his seminars are on that website too. So 10 years of seminars and different talks from other people. So Jay and Keir, they work together. Keir, who typically is my rugby strength coach, like that. That has been such a game changer in terms of teaching me different things of on the field for running or lifting. So that's my go-to for continuing education as related to strength and conditioning. Other than that, you got to read, like, you know, professional development books too.
I know that you are certified as a level 1 exercise nutrition coach with Precision Nutrition. And I know you also were talking a little bit earlier about the way that you've sort of leveraged your nutritionist there at Towson to get the best that you can for your athletes when it comes to fueling. I wonder if there are other things that you can share with us about your perspective on why nutrition is so important, maybe some things that get left out of the equation. Where do you come down on the importance of nutrition?
I would start with, you cannot outwork a bad diet. So it doesn't matter what training you're doing if you are not eating properly. So you cannot outwork a bad diet. And then this first answer is going to not sound that appealing, but sleep. You're not getting 8 hours of uninterrupted sleep where you're planning and prioritizing your sleep. And that also doesn't matter, because you don't get enough sleep, then you're going to eat the wrong thing and you're going to eat the wrong amount of things. So get your sleep. And then once you've prioritized and gotten your 8 hours of sleep, you know, I work really well with our nutritionist here, Christine Turpin, and the basics that we drive home to our athletes. One, eat breakfast. A lot of time they don't want to eat any breakfast. Eat breakfast, right? Never start a training session without having breakfast. Eat breakfast. Then at your meals, it's a really simple recipe. Where's your protein? Where's your quality carbohydrate? And then where's your fruit or vegetable? So if you follow that simple recipe, okay, protein for breakfast, eggs or yogurt. Where's your quality carbohydrate? Is it going to be some oatmeal? Is it going to be a piece of wheat bread? Is it a fruit or a vegetable? Do you want some berries? Do you want a banana? same recipe for lunch. All right, I'm going to have a piece of chicken, or I'm going to have a turkey breast sandwich, and I'm going to load it with vegetables. Great. Dinner, I'm going to have salmon with brown rice and steamed veggies. Just follow that simple recipe, and it really is that simple. Sleep for 8 hours, eat breakfast, and follow the protein, carbohydrate, fruit, or vegetable. Once you've gotten outside of doing that every single day and it's repeatable, and same thing, like we talk about acute to chronic ratio, can you chronically do that every single day? And when you've done that for months on end, that's when her and I will, we'll give them the different recommendations from either Precision Nutrition. We utilize the My Plate, like that understanding, like what an athlete's plate should look like visually. But, just utilizing that source. But even on that, on the My Plate, it's like, all right, where's your protein? Where's the carb? This is the vegetable. Like, follow that simple recipe and do it over time. That's when you start to see your results. That's when we see our results with our kids. Like, we had one freshman, he posted a picture of it from when he got here. And then a year later, he was on a straight linear periodization, but he now had access to food. He started sleeping. That's all we did. It really is that simple. Now, okay, he gained a bunch of weight. Now we can start to tweak things and make it a little bit more complicated. But we don't need to overcomplicate it. Sleep 8 hours, fruits, vegetables, lean protein, quality carbs.
We really appreciate all the time today, obviously, Coach. From going way back to, the panel discussion for football specifically, and then, now sharing with our strength and conditioning audience. Obviously it's clear that you're the type of individual that wants to give back and help coaches out as much as you possibly can. And, along those same lines, if coaches want to continue this conversation, they can reach out to you at jlima@towson.edu, email you there. Also follow you on Twitter at coach_j_lima or at coach.j.lima on Instagram. So, I would encourage coaches to follow you there and engage with you and continue this conversation. And like I said, we really appreciate all of the time today.
No problem. Thank you, Adam, and thank you for service to our country.
You're watching 3 Cycle Strength. Do you have a great idea for a topic or a guest on the show? Shoot us an email, team@3cyclestrength.com. All right, let's jump into this week's Kilogram, shall we? Kilograms is, of course, our weekly segment where we're shining a light on those who are killing it on Instagram. And this week's Kilogram is an oldie but a goodie. Comes to us from Coach Pat Ivy. You can follow him on Instagram at @DrCoach_PatIvy. Of course, if you haven't seen our episode with him, make sure that you check that out. As if folks didn't think that Coach Ivy was cool enough, here he is at the track on his bike, which looks like just way too much fun. The real reason that I wanted to highlight this clip on this week's Kilograms is because of this comment right here from a fellow master strength and conditioning coach, Jen Jones at Auburn. I would poop my pants. I'm sure that many of our viewers are split on this one between that looks like fun and this exact reaction. Whichever camp that you fall in, this week's Kilograms is for you. But obviously Coach Jones is amazing, and I appreciate us being able to laugh at her expense a little bit. That is it for another episode of 3 Cycle Strength. I hope that you all enjoyed it. Continue to engage with us on social media. Send me an email. Let me know how we can improve. We're taking it very seriously when it comes to getting better and growing and bringing you the topics that you want. So let us know. That's the open invitation always, of course, for you to reach out and engage with us on any of those social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, in our YouTube comments. And then, of course, sending us an email. Always willing and not just willing, but we need your feedback. So please let us know how we're doing. And until next time, stay humble and stay hungry.